Good morning to you all. I'm Pastor Tom Goodmanson from St. Paul Lutheran Church. You know, I never in my wildest imagination ever thought that I would experience this most holy week for us as Christians, living in seclusion rather than celebrating together as community. But we must make the best of these circumstances. Today we're celebrating Palm Sunday. Normally, you would all be receiving one of these palm crosses as you came in to worship today. And I'm guessing that a number of you still have your palm crosses from years past, and perhaps you might even have it with you right now. Let this palm cross remind us of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem that first Palm Sunday. Let it remind us of the sacrifice that Jesus made for us as he went to the cross in order to pay for every single last sin of our life and to buy us back from the dominion of Satan. Let this cross remind us that God has chosen to work through us to bring the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ to this broken world that we live in. He has no other plan. He is counting on us. So may God help us to live out his purpose for our life in this world. We now begin our service in the name of our triune God, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Old Testament prophecy that speaks about this very special day of Palm Sunday is found recorded in Zechariah from the Old Testament, chapter 9, beginning at verse 9. Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion, shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit. Return to your fortress, you prisoners of hope. Even now I announce that I will restore twice as much to you. This is the word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel we've chosen for today is found recorded in Matthew chapter 21, beginning at verse 1. This is the account of Jesus' Palm Sunday experience. It's recorded, "When they came near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples ahead of him. He said to them, 'Go into the village ahead of you. You will find a donkey tied there and a colt with it. Untie them, bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them. That person will send them at once.' This happened so that what the prophet had said came true. Tell the people of Zion, 'Your king is coming to you. He's gentle, riding on a donkey, on a colt, a young pack animal.' The disciples did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their coats on them for Jesus to sit on. Most of the people spread their coats on the road. Others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The crowd that went ahead of him and the one that followed him was shouting, 'Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!' When Jesus came into Jerusalem, the whole city was in an uproar. People were asking, 'Who is this?' The crowd answered, 'This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee.'" This is the gospel of the Lord. Let us join together now as we profess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." Let us join together now in prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for staying focused upon your mission of redeeming mankind from our sin so that all who trust in your suffering, death, and resurrection as the complete payment for all of their sins have your forgiveness now and the promise of eternal life with you in heaven. Even though the Palm Sunday crowds in Jerusalem baited you with their cries of "Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest," even though they baited you with that call to take immediate action to rescue them from the cruel tyranny of Rome's rule, you kept your eyes focused upon the cross. Be with us today as our world faces what one world leader just said is the greatest world crisis since World War II. Help us keep our eyes fixed upon your cross and the empty tomb, for this is the greatest evidence of your great love for us. Help us turn to your promises that you will not abandon us, but you will be with us to the very end of the age of life in this world. Fill us now with your peace that surpasses all understanding, so that we can bring this message of hope to the terrified world around us. We pray this in your name. Amen. Our triune God, we thank you for the blessing of the medical community that you've given us today. Please guard and protect our medical personnel from the COVID-19 virus as they treat our citizens who have been infected with the disease. Guide and direct the medical researchers who are searching for medications that will help us fight the virus and save lives. Give wisdom to President Trump and all of his advisors and the members of Congress as they seek to lead our nation during this critical time. Lord Jesus, Please grant healing according to your will to those who have been struck by the virus and other forms of illness. We especially include Barb Sider in this, as she has been moved from the hospital now to Pine Haven. And we think of Sandy Hammond, who was recently hospitalized and is now home recovering. Watch over them, guard them, and protect them. Continue to bring healing to their bodies according to your design and your will. Lord Jesus, the ultimate destroyer of death, you have provided a way to life everlasting. When our bodies die, you give us new and eternal life. Thank you for the life and the witness of faithful Christians who've gone before us, like Marion Prepster, who died last week. Make their lives a witness and a testimony to your amazing love. Lord Jesus, you also give us wonderful opportunities to celebrate your blessings in our lives. Please be with Randy and Sandy Seach and their family as they rejoice in the marriage of their daughter, Melanie Rohde, to Sean Wozniak. Help this couple to build their love and life together upon the foundation of a living faith in you, Lord Jesus. Into your hands we place all of our needs and all prayers of thanksgiving, knowing that you use your word to bless and to build us up for our good and for your glory. We pray this in Jesus' name and in the prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. At this time, we're going to dedicate the offerings that you all have been sending in. These are offerings that we have just received through the mail just recently. Many others of you have been giving through our website online. I want to thank you for your generosity during this time when we're not able to physically meet in order to be able to worship. Many of you have continued, as you can see, donating offerings by giving online and by sending in your offerings through the mail. Also, a new church secure drop box has been installed by the main entrance to the church for anyone who would prefer to drop your offering off at the church. Your generosity during this challenging time is necessary to support our staff and help us to continue to minister to everyone in new and creative ways. Let us now pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we bring these gifts to you in thanksgiving for your blessings that you shower upon us every day of our lives. Thank you for giving us occupations and jobs in which we can earn a living to support our families and to support your ministry of word and sacrament through this church. Guide and direct us, O Lord. We especially want to thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who came that first Palm Sunday, riding into Jerusalem, humble and lowly, in order that he might be the mighty, powerful Savior that he is for us today. Help us use these offerings you blessed us with in order that we might spread this message of hope and healing through faith in Jesus to everyone possible. We ask and pray this in our Savior's precious name. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, we turn to you now because you are our Savior, our Redeemer, the one who went and took the full brunt of Satan's condemning force. You took it all for us as you went to die on the cross on behalf of our sins, so that now our guilt is removed and we have the hope of heaven as we put our hope and our trust in you. Pour out your Spirit upon us now as we spend some time reflecting upon your word. Draw us ever closer to you through a living faith in Jesus, for we ask this in his name. Amen. I want to begin by asking you a question. Have you ever been mistaken for someone else? You know the kind of thing I'm talking about, where someone thinks that you look an awfully lot like someone else. Not long after we had moved here to Sheboygan County a couple of decades ago, I was shopping out at Walmart one day, and someone, a total stranger, comes up to me from out of the blue and says, "Are you on TV?" To which I, of course, said, "Why, no, why do you ask?" And they responded, "Because you sure look just like someone who is a news and weatherman on one of the Milwaukee TV stations." Well, I started checking out the news and weather anchors on the Milwaukee stations, and sure enough, there was a guy who looked a little bit like me, at least. His name is Mike Jacobs from WTMJ4. What do you think? Any resemblance? I'll let you be the judge. Mike retired 5 years ago. Over the years before he retired, I've had numerous people mistaken me for Mike Jacobs. Well, our theme for today, this Palm Sunday, is mistaken identity. You know, this was a constant problem for Jesus in a little bit different way. People wanted a physical king who would deliver them from the tyranny of the rule of Rome. They wanted someone who would heal them of their diseases and provide for their temporal needs in this world in which we live. And for good reason. The Old Testament prophets spoke of the coming Messiah, and they used terminology that sounded very worldly. For example, in Isaiah chapter 61, we read these words, "The Spirit of the Lord Almighty is with me." This is the Messiah now. "Is with me because the Lord has anointed me to deliver good news to humble people. He has sent me to heal those who are brokenhearted, to announce that captives will be set free and prisoners will be released." Wow, that really sounds good, doesn't it? In Isaiah chapter 9, this is a passage we always read at Christmas time. You'll recognize it well. "A child will be born for us, a son will be given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and peace will have unlimited growth. He will establish David's throne and kingdom. He will uphold it with justice and righteousness now and forever. The Lord of armies is determined to do this." Boy, that really sounds very world-centered, doesn't it? Jesus struggled with this idea of the people throughout his ministry. For example, in John chapter 6, we have recorded a tremendous miracle, a very famous miracle of Jesus. It's called the feeding of the 5,000, where he takes a couple of fish and a few loaves of bread and he multiplies it into this huge meal that serves thousands upon thousands of people. And then, right after the recording of that miracle is over, we're told this. "When the people saw the miracle Jesus had performed, they said, 'This man is certainly the prophet who is to come into the world.' Jesus realized that the people intended to take him by force and make him king. So he returned to the mountain by himself." He battled with this throughout his ministry. His popularity just got to people, and they wanted him to be their king. Even the disciples struggled with understanding what it meant for Jesus to be the Messiah. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus and the disciples are at the northernmost region of Israel at that time. It's called Caesarea Philippi. It was an area of great pagan worship. And Jesus asked the disciples a question. He asked them, "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Absolutely on target, Peter. He got it, didn't he? But his understanding of what that meant was a little misguided, because we're told a few verses later, from that time on, Jesus began to inform his disciples that he had to go to Jerusalem. There he would have to suffer a lot because of the leaders, the chief priests, and the experts in Moses' teachings. He would be killed, but on the third day he would be brought back to life. Peter took him aside and objected to this. Remember what he said? He said, "Heaven forbid! This must never happen to you." Oh my goodness. Why does he react this way? Because his Jewish notion of the Messiah is that when Messiah comes, he will be this militaristic, powerful king, just like David was about 1,000 years earlier. There was one particular prophecy of the coming Messiah that especially ignited the excitement of the people on this first Palm Sunday. It was the idea that he would raise people to life from the dead. It's recorded in Isaiah chapter 26, reads this way. The path of the righteous is level. O upright one, that would be Messiah, you make the road of the righteous smooth. And now listen to this. Your dead will live. Their corpses will rise. Those who lie dead in the dust will wake up and shout for joy, because your dew is a refreshing dew, and the earth will revive the spirits of the dead. Wow. Guess what's just happened near Jerusalem, just outside of Jerusalem, in Bethany. Jesus has just a couple of days earlier raised a man from the dead, his very good friend Lazarus. Listen to the words that are recorded in John chapter 11. Jesus is standing there by the grave of Lazarus, and we're told, "So the stone was moved from the entrance to the tomb. Jesus looked up and said, 'Father, I thank you for hearing me. I've known that you always hear me. However, I've said this so that the crowd standing around me will believe that you sent me.'" After Jesus had said this, he shouted as loudly as he could, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out. Strips of cloth were wound around his feet and hands, and his face was wrapped with a handkerchief. Jesus told them, "Free Lazarus and let him go." Many Jews who had visited Mary and had seen what Jesus had done believed in him, but some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. So they've gone back to Jerusalem to tell the Pharisees on Jesus. So the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the council. They asked, "What are we going to do? This man is performing a lot of miracles. If we let him continue what he's doing, everyone will believe in him. Then the Romans will take away our position and our nation." You know what's happening here? Jesus is setting the scene for the final conflict between he and the religious authorities that will culminate in his crucifixion on the cross. And so now we come a couple of days later, after the raising of Lazarus, Jesus is coming, riding into Jerusalem that first Palm Sunday amid all of the cheers and the fanfare of the people. "Hosanna to the Son of David," they cry out. "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Guess what they're really thinking? The key here in understanding what the crowds are thinking is the use of this word Hosanna. It's a Hebrew word. It literally means save now. They wanted Jesus to be their temporal worldly savior. They wanted him to be a military king, just like David had been 1,000 years earlier. They wanted deliverance now from the severe physical cruelty and massive taxation that Rome imposed upon them. Deliverance from sin, death, and Satan would be good if it was thrown in with the package, but that wasn't front and center on their minds right now. And when he didn't deliver immediately on their most pressing expectations, well, you know how they would turn on him days later and cry out at the top of their lungs, "Crucify him, crucify him." Right now, our nation, in fact, our entire world, is caught up in the most severe worldwide pandemic of any of our lifetimes. quarantines, social distancing, panic buying of many consumer goods, closures of many businesses and services, daily media updates on the numbers of people infected by the COVID-19 virus and those who have died from it. All of this has created a sort of hysteria that is causing many to cry out to God for deliverance. We are begging God to protect us from the disease and destroy the virus from our planet so that our lives can get back to a sense of normalcy. And all of that is well and good. But here is my great concern, that in the midst of our Hosanna cries, we not lose sight of our Savior Jesus, who he really came to be, what kind of a Messiah, what kind of a Savior he is. He is our Savior from sin, first and foremost. I'm concerned that if this virus drags out for a considerable length of time, that many of those who have been turning to God with their cries of Hosanna, save us now, will soon turn away from God, thinking that he has somehow abandoned them. Their image of Jesus as Savior is primarily that he should rescue them from their pain and their suffering now, or else what good is he? Do you remember Jesus' words to Pilate as he stood on trial this coming week during Holy Week? Pilate asked him, are you a king? And Jesus responded, my kingdom is not of this world. Jesus came first and foremost to pay for our sins. He came not to bring paradise to this world, but to prepare our hearts and our minds for heaven in the world to come. He has promised, I will never leave you or forsake you. He has promised, be faithful even unto death, and I will give you the crown of everlasting life. And we know we can trust his promises because he went to the cross. He kept his eyes fixed upon that mission, focused like a laser beam. Even the crowds couldn't deter him with their cries of Hosanna and all of the cheers and the laud that they were giving to him. None of that could deter him from his purpose, from his mission. This Palm Sunday, let our first cry to God be, Lord God, please forgive my sins for Jesus' sake. And then follow with, Lord, if it is your will, please deliver our world from this pandemic. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. May God bless us with such a heart and such faith in Jesus, now and always. In his precious name we pray, amen. I would invite you now to join me as we turn to God in our time of confession of sins. You know, on this Palm Sunday, as we celebrate Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem and the beginning of his week of passion, we are reminded of what God said and told the Old Testament Israelites in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. Looking into the future, when Israel would sin by turning away from trusting in God, the Lord told King Solomon, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. End of quote. From that point on, Israel often turned away from trusting in God, falling into the trap of materialism, worship of idols, child sacrifice even to some of those idols, and many, many other sins. As a result, they would encounter the discipline of God in many ways throughout history, till the time of Jesus, when they were ruled by the foreign oppressive power of Rome. At this time, they desperately wanted a Savior, but not the kind of Savior God had in mind for them. Today, in the midst of this pandemic we are facing in our world, the church, God's people, must begin at the same starting point that God called Israel to, that of repentance. Let us together confess our sins to God. Our triune God, we come to confess our sins to you. We've been so abundantly blessed by you with freedom, material prosperity, world-class medical care, nearly full employment in our country, and so much more. Yet we have complained about not having enough and have stood by silently as our culture has pushed you farther and farther from it, choosing to worship the blessings rather than you, the provider of them all. We admit that we have turned our devotion away from you, O Lord. And now as this virus attacks our world, we are afraid. Like the Israelites of Jesus' day, we want a Savior, but one who will deliver us from this present enemy, not necessarily a spiritual Savior to deliver us from our sins. Dear Lord God, today we ask you to forgive our self-centered sins for Jesus' sake. And raise us up as your ambassadors of hope to the dying world around us. Teach us to set our eyes and our hearts upon building your spiritual kingdom that lasts forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, the Bible has all kinds of hope for us. For example, the words of St. Paul given to us in Colossians chapter 1. God has rescued us from the power of darkness and has brought us into the kingdom of his Son whom he loves. His Son has paid the price to free us, which means that our sins are forgiven. Isn't that wonderful news? That's the basis of our hope today. It's not on deliverance from some pandemic or virus or anything else. It is on this promise of God's amazing love to us in Jesus. Based upon this truth, it is my privilege to share with all of you who have confessed your sins and are trusting in Jesus as your Savior, you are forgiven of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now receive the benediction of our Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen.
Before we sing our closing song, Hosanna Praises Rising, I'd like to share the text of the pre-chorus with you. It says, "When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away." Let us focus on our victorious God in the midst of this health crisis, that he will give us strength to face these days. And let us remember that God is always with us, that his presence will wash all of our current fears away. Let's sing and praise our King.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away, Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises, Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way. Sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna.
I want to thank you for joining us for this online Palm Sunday worship service. May God richly bless you this week as you grow in entrusting all of the details of life into the all-powerful but grace-filled hands of our triune God. In closing, I want to make you aware of a plastic bin that's been placed outside the front of, by the front door is the main entrance of our church. We've had people asking how they can get copies of the Portals of Prayer booklets, the new ones that begin with the month of April. We have placed a bunch of them out there, so if you would like to help yourself to them, you'll find that plastic bin sitting out there. Just help yourself and enjoy the devotions as they lead you into the presence of God daily. God bless. Have a wonderful, wonderful week as you serve Him with joy and thanksgiving.